Well, there's something missing on our platform, the Sabbath. Anybody notice what it is? We have no rebirthday cake. We should be sad. I have good news, though. Next Sabbath, we're going to have another cake here. Because we have two baptisms to celebrate. Amen? Amen? So, yes. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. Amen. I'm going to remind you to remind me at the close of our service, we're going to have prayer corners available for those that would like to join for some added prayer. Again, one will be, as it was announced, one will be back on this side in the back of the church, and the other prayer corner will be here in the front. And I'd like to encourage you, especially those that are feeling an extra needed booster shot for today and for the week, or maybe you are there to encourage someone else, please feel free to join those corners for prayer. We're not going to keep you there all day, just for a short while. But again, we want to be known as a church that prays. Church that prays. And I'll try to remember that. I've got my little note right here for my ADD to remind me to announce that at the close of the service as well. I want to invite you to take your Bibles and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I have to admit, I have various favorite scripture passages, but this is one of my top 10, I would say, top 10, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and it begins with verse 14. The Apostle Paul says, "For Christ's love," some versions use constrain, okay, my version used the word compels. So notice it's not restraining someone, it's constraining and it's compelling. In other words, it's a drawing force. It's kind of like a magnet drawing a piece of metal, right? "For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all." That's Jesus. Jesus died for how many? He died for all, and therefore all died. If you don't understand that portion of the phrase, you can see me after the church service. We can have a Bible study. But what it's basically saying is in Christ, all of humanity was there, and in Christ we all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for whom? For him, the one who died for us. That's right. And he was what? Raised again. So verse 16. So from now on, because of this new birth experience, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Although it says we had looked at Christ in that way, we do so no longer. In other words, what does that mean to look at someone with a worldly point of view? Maybe with contempt, judgment. Was Christ looked on with contempt? Was he judged? Yeah, these things. But in this new birth experience, we don't regard people from a worldly point of view any longer. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new what? He's a new creature, a new creation. The old, what has happened to the old? It's gone away, right? What's come? New. There's a new mind, Paul says in another place, that we need to have the Christian has a renewing of our mind, a transformation of our mind, right? And he says in verse 18, he says, "All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ, and he has given us a ministry." So every one of us in this church, who claims to be born again, you have a ministry that we all share. What is that ministry? The ministry of reconciliation. Notice what he says in verse 19. In other words, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them, and he has therefore committed us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore his, what? We're Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. Paul goes on, he says, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God, for God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. Amen. Wow. What a powerful, we could just say amen, close the books, have prayer and go home. But I got more to say. Not going to let you off that easy this morning. Wow. It all starts with Christ's love that compels us, that draws us to him. And if we don't resist that love, as one author says, if we don't resist that love, what will it naturally do? Transform us. It draws us to him and transforms our lives. I don't know why anyone would choose to resist. Last week, we looked at a story found in the book of Luke. It was Luke chapter 10. Does anybody remember what story it was that we looked at in Luke chapter 10? I think it was last Sabbath. I'm getting older now, so sometimes I think it was last Sabbath. We took a glimpse at the story of what's been titled the Good Samaritan. And if you remember, there's the story about where this Jew, this man, was on his way on the roadside, and he was jumped by robbers and thieves. They stripped him naked. They took everything that he had, even the shirt off his back, and they left him for dead. And we had various people going down that pathway, other travelers. One I remember mentioning, it was the conference president. The other one was the pastor of the Caldwell Church. And they saw this guy in need, and they just walked right on by. And the reason they walked right on by is because they were insecure in something. Does anybody remember what I mentioned? What were they insecure about? Being unclean. Which, another way of saying being unclean, it would affect their righteousness, their holiness, right? Yeah. So I don't want to become unrighteous by dealing with this person. I want to maintain my standard of righteousness, my standard of holiness, so that I can go to the temple. But then this despised individual, this despised Samaritan, because again, remember, the victim is a Jew, the conference president, in other words, was a Jew, and so was the pastor of that Jewish sect. And they walked by their brother, but this despised one saw him and took compassion on him and bound up his wound, cleaned up his wounds, took care of him, put him on his donkey or whatever his traveling transportation was, and takes him where? Takes him to the inn. And he stays overnight with him at the end and cares for him and binds up his wounds. And I mean, remember, he was left dead. So, I mean, he's still wounded, right? But the traveler has to be on his way, the Samaritan, and so he goes to the innkeeper. He gives them a down payment, so to speak, or pays in full and says, here, this is all it should take. Please continue to care for him, and when I return on the way, if there's any debt outstanding, I'll take care of it. Right? I'll take care of it. Who's the Good Samaritan? in the story? Jesus. Because the people he was telling the story to that were there were some of the religious leaders who despised him. He eats with publicans and sinners, right? So there was a despise for him. And so this person who stops along the way is Jesus. Who do you think the person on the side of the road is? Anyone who is in need. It's the world. The world is in need, aren't we? Perishing world, right? The enemy comes in to steal, to kill, to destroy. That's John 10:10. Comes in to steal, to kill, destroy. Do we see that in the Good Samaritan story? Absolutely. Jesus says, though, I come along that you might have life and have life more abundantly. What's the end? It's the church. It's the church. So Jesus is the Savior, right? Who binds up our wounds, who brings healing, and then he takes that group and entrusts them to his church, which represents his body, represents him. And as we read there in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we are his ambassadors, right? We're his representatives. And so we're to care for this individual. We're to care for one another. Now remember, it's not a pretty picture when this man was brought to the inn. Things were not going well. He was a mess, right? He was a mess. And yet Jesus had compassion on him. Loved him, brought healing, and took him to church. So there's a lesson for that in us, for us. Some of us were that hot mess. Some of us still have scars, maybe even some wounds that are still healing. And yet we're to be continuing to care for one another. Till when? Till Jesus returns, right? Doesn't matter how broken they are. Doesn't matter what they look like. Doesn't matter how infectious they are. Jesus has had compassion on them. Has died for them. By his stripes they are healed, right? And he asks us to journey along and care for one another. So this brings me now to our passage found in Matthew. The book of Matthew. We've been going through the Sermon on the Mount. And I want to get to Matthew chapter 7. And before we go any further, I just want to have an added word of prayer. Father in heaven, I thank you for your goodness and your kindness. I thank you, Jesus, that you left the comforts of heaven for me. And I pray now, Jesus, that as you promised, you said, if parents know how to give good gifts to their children, how much your Father in heaven will give the Holy Spirit to them that ask. And Jesus, you said that when you return, you had to say, I've got to go back to heaven because unless I go back to heaven, the Holy Spirit will not be sent. And so Jesus, you went to heaven and you said you would send the Holy Spirit. I pray for his presence now in my life, that you would help me as I speak, to speak your words, not simply my own. And I pray, Lord, that my heart, as well as each heart that hears my voice at this time, whether it's here in this church building or whether it'll be by the internet, Lord, I pray that every heart will be softened and that your love will just help open that heart so that your word can be sown and bring forth fruit. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I read chapter 7, or the first few verses, we're not going to read all of chapter 7. Before I read these first few verses, I have to tell you a story. Years ago, when I was in college, I met one of the pastors, leaders of our denomination within the Mid-America Union. His name was Jim Kress. Some of you might have known him, Jim. He's since passed away. But Jim was a great guy. He was had done evangelism for years. And he told us a story one time of where he and his wife, and he had a singing evangelist and his wife, and they all were going to visit a church where they were going to be doing meetings in the upcoming months. But they wanted to make an initial visit to the church. And so Jim and Sharon and their singing evangelist and his wife, they show up to church. Unfortunately, something happened in their transportation and on the way, and so they arrived there after Sabbath school just in time. Well, actually, it wasn't even there in time for the worship service as a whole. It was just there for the sermon. They get there just before the pastor is getting up to preach. They kind of sneak in the back row, and they sit in the back, and they start to listen to the sermon. And as they're sitting in the back, they're noticing that this is kind of an unruly congregation. I mean, the pastor's up front and speaking, and there's a lot of whispering going on in the church. A lot of talking, even some note passing, some just shaking of heads. And, you know, as Jim was listening to the message, the pastor was not very enthusiastic, but very slow in speech, almost slurring his words. And so Jim is sitting there and he's like, oh my word. He leans over to his wife. He says, we're not doing meetings in this church. Long story short, the church service ends. The pastor goes slowly, methodically, walks down the aisle. His wife takes him by the arm. They go past, and before they pass Jim and Sharon, she goes, here, you're invited to lunch. Gives them a sheet of paper, where a map to their house, and they leave and go out the door. They don't even greet the congregation. And Jim says again, I'm calling the conference on Monday. We are not doing meetings in this church. Not bringing someone in this church. They go to the pastor's house. They get to the pastor's house and things even get worse. I can't tell you the whole story that now, but if you want to hear the story, it's really laughable. But I'll have to cut to the chase. What they discovered was that morning, the pastor accidentally drank the orange juice that had the sedative in it for his mother-in-law, who they had to leave at home because she was convalescing, so to speak, and she'd get out of control, and so they'd give her a type of sedative to calm her down and get her to sleep. He gave her his juice, and he drank her juice. The reason there was so much commotion in the church was the church was saying, what has happened to our pastor? Has he had a stroke? Because he's talking so slowly and with a slur. So they were convinced that somebody had needed to do something, and so they were talking amongst themselves. His wife had figured out what had happened, and she wanted to get him home as quickly as possible and just get him out of the church. Jim actually found out, Jim and Sharon shared with us, that that was one of the better churches that they ever did a meeting in through their experience. They shared this story with us young pastors and our spouses because they wanted us to make sure that we understood not to make snap judgments and not to be judgmental because we don't know necessarily the whole story. right? Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, beginning with verse 1, he says, "Do not judge, or you too will be what? Judge." Now again, I don't believe that Jesus isn't talking about, hey, don't use good discernment, don't use good judgment, because later on he talks about, he says, hey, in verse 6, he says, "Do not give dogs what is sacred, and don't throw your pearls to the pigs or before the swine." Okay, so that has to take some kind of judgment in there, right? And then later on, he says, beware of false prophets, right? So he's not saying hey, you shouldn't make any type of judgment. What he's stating, though, I believe, is don't be judgmental. And I think that's what we're going to see here as we begin to unpack this. Because he says, do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way that you judge others, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. I'm going to tell you another story. Years ago, I was at an event called Promise Keepers. This was a Christian gathering for men. It was in Mile High Stadium in Colorado. There were over 70,000 men present there that weekend to hear the Word of God being presented and to challenge us to be faithful in our integrity as men who follow Christ. And there was a time in the presentation, in one of the presentations, that the presenter asked all the pastors who were present that day, those that had led congregations, to stand up so that they might be recognized by those around them as being pastors. So I went ahead and I stood up. Two rows down from me, to the far left, was a good-sized gentleman, long hair with a ponytail, tattoos on his arms. He was in a leather vest, right? With pointy things on him. And they said, now I want you to do what I want the rest of you to do is I want you to gather around these pastors. I want you to lay hands on them and pray for them. And all of a sudden, this big burly guy just shot up, turned around, looked at me, our eyes met, and he was coming toward me, and I was like, oh boy, this guy's gonna lay hands on me. And he came over. And he laid his hands on me. And he prayed the most incredible prayer of blessing. And he was weeping as he prayed. And I felt God's anointing coming through that man as he wept over me. And guess what? I'm not a crier, I'm more of a crier now that I'm older. I might be going through menopause, you know. But then I wasn't a crier. I was one of those guys, no, you don't cry. But I was crying as this man prayed over me. You see, I looked at him and I made a judgment about that man. God used him to bring a judgment upon me. And a spirit of humility and humbleness before God. Jesus says, don't judge that you may not be judged. Again, he's not talking about making discernment. He's not talking about coming into agreement with things that are not something that we should be condoning. But he said, don't ever look at someone with that judgmental heart and condemning them. That is not our place. Look what he says in verse 3. He says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye, but you don't pay attention to the plank in your own eye? Can you imagine that? I mean, we're talking about a speck. Now we're talking about a 2x4. Can you imagine someone with a 2x4 in their eye, let alone even trying to think about taking a speck out of somebody else's eye because of the log that they have in theirs, their plank? It's impossible. You can't even get near someone to see the speck in their eye. Jesus says in verse 5, you what? Hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. You ever had a speck in your eye? Oh, my word. It can be the tiniest thing, but it is the greatest irritant. It feels like a plank. And it's there, and you don't want to scratch your eye. Don't rub your eye. You know, they don't rub your eye. What's the first thing you want to do? Rub your eye. You got to get this thing out. And so you're walking around, and then you try flushing it with water. That hasn't done me a whole lot of good sometimes in the past. And it's still there. And finally, I have to go to my wife or whoever's there. Do you see something? Do you see a speck in there? Can you get it out? Can you get it out? If you got a plank in your eye, you better go see a specialist. Right? If you got a speck in your eye, it's not always best that you try to take it out. It's best that you go find someone who knows what they're seeing and what they're doing. But Jesus says, how ridiculous that sometimes we want to look down, we look at other people, and we begin to judge them, and we want to remove a little speck in their life, but all along we've got a plank in our own life. He says, you hypocrites. What's a hypocrite? Yeah, it's a someone who says, oh, I'm here for your good, but I'm really not. Sometimes that happens in prayer requests. Oh, pastor, you know we need to pray for sister so-and-so. And you know, because she blah, 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 blah. I was like, whoa, wow. Sometimes are they being sincere about that? You know? But it can happen. So why we're not to judge not, as in to belittle or punish or condemn, we are to use sound judgment and be discerning. And that's really what the rest of Matthew 7 is really about. We're not going to look at all Matthew 7 today. We're just going to look at just a few things here. Turn with me to the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. Ephesians, chapter 2. Where are we going? Ephesians, that's right. Chapter 2. And we look at Ephesians chapter 2. And start with verse 1. That's not the main point, but we're going to start with verse 1. As for you, he's speaking to believers now, you were dead in your what? You're like that Samaritan, or that passenger who was robbed, stolen from, left half dead. You were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of the world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are what? Disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time. So in all of us, the whole human race at one time, we were in the same condition. We were in the same boat, so to speak, right? He says, all of us were there at one time. We were gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature, following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, because of what? His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. Man traveling on the road. The despised Samaritan. Here it is again. And God raised us up with Christ, and he seated us with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show his incomparable riches of his grace. Incomparable riches of what? His grace. Expressed in the kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For again, Paul says, it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by your works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship. Whose workmanship? God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do what? To do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. What is the good works that believers are to do? The ministry of reconciliation. Going back to 2 Corinthians 5. He's given us a ministry of reconciliation, not of condemning. Now, I know that there are other Christians which doctrine we don't necessarily agree with. My mom did not keep the seventh day Sabbath. My dad did not keep the seventh day Sabbath. But I believe they were sincere in their worship of God. Now, I'm going to say some things here. Don't hear what I'm not saying. But I think we need to hear it. Sometimes we, as Seventh-day Adventists, worship the Sabbath more than the creator of the Sabbath. And we look down our noses in a judgmental way and almost already brand people who are worshiping on a different day than us as being less than us and already having the mark of the beast. Now, I don't know about you, but I read the story there in the book of Daniel. And I believe probably that first king of Babylon is going to be in heaven. And if God can save and turn the heart of the first king of Babylon, I just wonder if it might be possible that some of the other kings that sit on that seat, that God can turn their hearts as well. And rather than maybe preaching or bringing up a message of condemnation over these individuals, that really, in a sense, we do to puff ourselves up in our righteousness, if we would spend more time praying like Daniel and his friends did, ministering to, I wonder how many would find their way to the kingdom. I hope I'm not misunderstood here this morning. I believe the Sabbath message. I believe in resting in Christ. But I don't believe in promoting that message at the condemnation of, I don't need to resurrect or raise the Sabbath up as condemning others who don't see things that way. Saved by grace, by the work that God has done. There was another story, and I'll just mention this. You can look it up later, look at the story, but it was in John chapter 8 where Jesus mentioned the story of a woman caught in adultery that was brought to him. Basically, for the motive, again, a hypocrisy was there because on the surface they were saying, hey, we caught this woman in adultery, and we know what the law of Moses says. Jesus, do you know what the law of Moses says? And what do you say concerning to the law of Moses? And they were doing this all to entrap Jesus because he was going to be guilty if he did and guilty if he didn't in the sense of their judgment. Because if he condemned this woman to death, he would be in defiance of Roman law, and he could therefore then be taken by Rome and put to death if he said that this woman should be stoned. And if he frees her, well, then he's not really a follower of the law of Moses. So he's caught in a catch-22. And as the story goes, Jesus knelt down and he began to write in the sand. And as he's writing in the sand, he's not saying anything. The onlookers start to gather around. They're pressing in, and especially some of the older men, they're looking at what Jesus is writing in the sand. And I believe that part of what Jesus was writing in the sand was the law of Moses, because the law of Moses also spoke and said, if you catch a couple in the act of adultery, it is the husband's responsibility. If it's this way, it's the husband, it's the spouse's responsibility to bring this report along with the other guilty party, and both of them should be stoned. Where was the other person? Where was the husband? And so Jesus is writing out the law, they in pointing out in some respects that they're breaking the law, because now they're bringing it, where's the woman, where's the man? I believe he's also writing out the secret things of some of their own hearts. For I believe that these very men who were condemning this woman were the ones who were guilty of leading this woman into the act of adultery. And Jesus says, after he's been writing, now, whoever of us here is not guilty of sin, you get to throw the first stone. And as the story goes, the stone started to drop to the ground, and the men began to leave. You mean there wasn't one person there that wasn't guilty that day that could have actually picked up the stone and stoned her? Because she did. The question wasn't, well, did she commit adultery? She was guilty. Wasn't there an innocent person there? Jesus. Jesus was the only righteous one there. Jesus is the only one who had the right of picking up the stone and stoning this woman. But did he?
No.
He asked the woman, where are your accusers? She lifted up her head and looked around and she says, there are none. Neither do I condemn you. Now, Jesus didn't finish there. He says, now, go and leave your life of sin. Leave it in the past. Reconciliation. He brought this woman to the foot of the cross. And he says, neither do I condemn you. Now go and leave your life of sin. Isn't that what the church is to be doing? As Romans 8:1 says, there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And as believers, we don't look at the world in a worldly point of view anymore. We see them through the eyes of who? Of heaven, of Jesus, of the Father. When we're told, one writer of our denomination wrote, she said, when God looks at us, he sees us through the eyes of his son. He looks and he says, I don't see a sinner. I see my son. I see my daughter. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. We don't deserve it. Why we were powerless, why we were sinners, why we were his enemies, Christ died for us, Romans chapter 5 says. Now at the same time, I'm not condoning sin. I'm not saying sin is okay. But I'm saying we need to understand we too have been trapped in that at times. We know what it's like. What we need is a message of reconciliation. What we need is a message of love that's so powerful that it can't be resisted. Now, let's finish up real quick. I'm going to finish up with Matthew, verse 6. Chapter 7 and verse 6. Because notice what Jesus says. He says in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 6, he says, "Do not give dogs what is sacred, and do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet, and they may turn and tear you to pieces." Two things here as I mention this. One is that the pearls that are mentioned here, I believe, represent the gospel. This is the gospel. This is the pearl of great price that's mentioned later on in Matthew chapter 13, verses 45 to 46. And so I believe that that's what this pearl of great price represents. But who or what does Jesus mean by referencing the dogs and the pigs? Well, I believe what this means is the command not to give dogs what is sacred or to cast pearls before the pigs or the swine doesn't mean that we refrain from preaching the gospel to people who are out in the highways and byways. Jesus himself ate and he taught. He ate with sinners and he taught with them, right? He came down, he mingled with humanity as one who desired their good, right? But here, Jesus uses dogs and pigs as representative of those who repeatedly ridicule, reject, or blaspheme the gospel. In short, Jesus is saying, look, if you're going to someone and they're just like, they're not interested, he's saying the same things as he said in his disciples when he says, when you go preaching and you get into a town and they're not receiving the message, don't sit there and continue to bring before them, because they're just taking the pearls and trampling under feet. They're trampling the Son of Man under their feet. He says, shake the dust off. Right? Shake the dust off and go to the next town. Why? Because the harvest is ready and the laborers are few. It doesn't mean that those people will never receive the gospel. They're not ready yet. And why are you going to sit there and waste your breath when there's someone out here saying, help me? Why waste your breath over here while there's someone there going to their knees for the first time and saying, God, if you're real, send something to me. I'm going to close with this story. Years ago, it was in between my freshman and sophomore year of college. I received the invitation, but my family all went. It was my wife, my two boys. God provided a way for us to leave the comforts of our apartment there at Union College, and we went to Colorado. And we stayed in the home of a non-Adventist family in their basement. My wife did daycare for my kids in the one other lady that was a single mom and needed her child care for, while I went out with other students and we knocked on doors and we were offering information about Jesus. Adventists call it call portering. More modern name, literature evangelists. Now they call it big book or mega books. Whatever, I don't know, maybe that's even an old term. I had not gotten into a house in I don't know how many days. I was ready to quit. I was like, God, I'm sick of this. I don't like doors slammed in my face. And God, you see these houses right here? That's it. This is it right here. These three or four houses, I'm done after this. Done. I get to the last house. Knock on the door. A woman comes to the door. I said, hi, my name is Lou Fitting. I'm with Home Health Educational Services, and I'm here to offer you life assurance. She goes, you're an insurance salesman? I said, no, I don't sell insurance. I'm offering life assurance in Jesus. Her eyes got big. She goes, come on in. Long story short, because time is up, I share with them the Bible story books. The young boy that was probably about 10 or 11 years old there said, let's do half. I'm thinking a half of a set. He's talking about he'll pay for half the books if she would pay for half the books. Turned out that this young boy wasn't even her son, it was her nephew. A month or two before that, his mother was murdered. Didn't know where the father was at. But this single woman who never had children, middle-aged woman, not even understanding children, is now in custody of this boy to raise him. They've been at loggerheads and different things. She wasn't really a practicing Christian at all, neither was he. But she got to the point in their discussion that night that she says, you know what? We need to stop and we're going to pray. And if there is a God in heaven, he probably didn't say this to him, but if there's a God in heaven, he's going to help me. They had just finished praying when the knock came on the door. And when she heard the name Jesus, her heart just went whoosh, and shared the story. This boy had an inheritance, and that's why he was willing to pay half. Friends, there's people out there. The harvest is ready. What are we doing here? I know you hear this. I bring this up, and I'm not trying to bring any guilt or condemnation on any of us. We're all guilty. What I'm saying is we got good stuff. And if the people that you're trying to share with aren't receptive, God bless them. Pray a blessing over them and find someone else. Because I can guarantee you, there's another lady and another boy and another family and another man who are just, they're at their wits' ends. And they're saying, God, send somebody. That somebody may just be you and I. Today, I invite us all as we go out into our week, as we leave this place, that we never look at a person the same again. That we see them as sons and daughters of God who Jesus died for. And those who are made aware of that or are opening their hearts to that, that we would ask Jesus, don't give me 20/20 vision. Give me X-ray vision to know that I can see with your eyes and find the harvest. Let's pray. Father in heaven, as we sing our closing song, I pray that you would help me, that you would help our church family, you'd help those, Lord, that are listening by the audience or the World Wide Web today or in the future. I pray, oh God, that you would help us to see with new eyes. And we would never, ever look upon anyone from a worldly point of view any longer. That we would have good discernment, good judgment, but we would not have condemnation. That we would remind ourselves it is by grace that we have been saved through faith in Jesus Christ alone. While we were yet dead in our transgressions and sins, Christ died for me. He died for each one of us. And because of that, Lord, I pray that you would help us again to take that ministry of reconciliation that you've given to every believer, that we might beseech others to show them the way, to help bind up their wounds, to care for them and lead them on the path to heaven. I thank you for hearing and answering this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, I want you to remind you as the praise team is coming forward, we have our prayer corners that will be right after the benediction. And again, in the back over here on the organ side and in the front of our church over here on the piano side. If you have not given your life to Jesus yet, don't hesitate. If you're not quite there to make that decision, that's okay. Let us know so we can be praying for you. If you'd like to know more, we'd be happy to share Bible studies with you to let you know again who Jesus is and what he thinks about you. Father, thank you so much for your grace this morning. Thank you for your saving love. Father, as we leave this place, thank you for the fellowship we've enjoyed here today. Thank you for allowing us to be in the presence of your sweet, sweet Spirit. But now, Lord, we're going out into the mission field, out into the highways and the byways. It may not be as comfortable as it is in here. It may not be as welcoming as it is in here. But Jesus, just like you left the comforts of heaven and you came to this planet called Earth to redeem and to save humanity, Lord, by your command, your commission, we leave this place to go out into the mission field. We're leaving the comforts of this church, the comforts of this fellowship, and we ask you, Lord Jesus, that we bring hope, that we bring a message of joy, that we bring a message of salvation to our community and the whole world. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.